Belka and Strelka weren't actually the first animals in space. Why were dogs chosen for such an important mission, and was anyone else on that flight? In this video, I'll answer these and many other questions. For example, what do jellyfish have to do with it? And if you watch the video to the end, you'll find out which animal not only went to space, but was also born there. Enjoy watching. The year was 1960. Two stray dogs were on board a rocket. Their names are now known to everyone, but back then, it was just another experiment. These dogs were captured directly from the streets of Moscow and sent immediately to the State Scientific Research and Testing Institute of Aviation and Space Medicine. In short, a special scientific center. There, these former stray mixed-breed dogs underwent pre-flight training. First, their space was restricted for several days. Then electrodes were implanted to monitor their condition through sensors, and they were acclimated to clothing and G-forces. They were all being prepared to become cosmonauts. But why mutts? Why not monkeys or other animals? Dr. Adelia Kotovskaya, Doctor of Medical Sciences, answered this question. Their lives are tough, cold, hunger. This means they are accustomed to various environmental conditions. Secondly, dogs have a great relationship with humans, who are their masters. They train well. And thirdly, the physiology of dogs has been well studied since Ivan Pavlov's time. Belka and Strelka, like all the others, were found on the street. They perfectly matched all the criteria. Age between 2 and 6 years, weight no more than 13 pounds, height 13 inches. And of course, they were friendly, loyal to humans, and photogenic. In case the experiment succeeded, these mutts were destined to become the new stars of the Soviet Union. As you already know, the experiment was successful. On August 19, 1960, Belka and Strelka flew into space, made 17 complete orbits around the Earth, and returned successfully to the designated point. This was a real breakthrough in space exploration, because the dogs not only returned to Earth, but also remained completely healthy and unharmed. A few months later, Strelka even gave birth to 6 completely healthy puppies. By the way, an interesting fact, there were not only stray dogs on that flight. That day, 12 mice, insects, and, according to unconfirmed reports, a rabbit were also sent to space. Unfortunately, their names have been erased from history, and I believe this is a huge oversight for rodent lovers. In almost any scientific experiment, from radiation exposure and new drug testing to genome modification, the most frequently used test subjects are rodents. Space is no exception. Mice, rats, hamsters, and guinea pigs regularly went into orbit. And who was the first? According to some reports, the first was a rat named Mr. Jim from the USA. He was born in Germany, in the only sterile laboratory at the time, and was then taken out of the country to participate in the space program. On May 25, 1953, he made a successful flight and returned to Earth alive. Then there were rats on the same famous flight with Belka and Strelka. They even appeared in a video. Here, take a look at them. Interestingly, the stray dogs became heroes after the flight, destined for a long and well-fed life. But the rodents were likely euthanized and dissected to obtain data on the flight's effects on their bodies. Unfortunately, this is the fate that awaits almost all small animal cosmonauts. Later, many other countries, including France, Germany, China, and Argentina, also sent rodents into space. The most famous flight occurred on February 22, 1961. A rat named Hector spent 40 minutes in space, suspended and stretched out. Again, all for the sake of science. Interestingly, another rodent was initially supposed to fly, but it showed incredible disobedience, chewed through several cables, and was replaced. Even today, rats continue to be sent into space, but unfortunately, only for laboratory research. The only difference between new experiments and old ones is that now rats are less frequently returned to Earth. They are killed directly on board the International Space Station. Interestingly, the function of returning to Earth wasn't considered for a long time. Most of the first space flights with anime, all on board were one-way trips, regardless of whether the launch was successful or not, whether the rocket reached the edge of space or fell earlier. Cosmonauts simply burned alive, froze, or suffocated. Before Belka and Strelka, another dog, a stray named Laika, had been in orbit. She was sent into space on November 3, 1957, almost a month after the launch of the first Soviet satellite. The problem was that the animal was launched on a similar spacecraft. At that time, there was no spacecraft built to return the crew to Earth, so for Laika, it was a one-way ticket. The information about this flight caused an outcry among animal rights activists. Almost every newspaper in the world wrote about Laika, and Western journalists called her the loneliest and most unfortunate dog. In the USSR, such a negative reaction was surprising, as the country had made even greater sacrifices for science. As a result, the image of cute Laika in a spacesuit became iconic. She remains the heroine of songs, books, films, comics, and anime. And in terms of popularity, she seriously rivals Belka and Strelka. Other dogs have also flown in space. According to some data, there are 48 Soviet and 2 Chinese stray dog heroes. Some died, like Laika, and were forgotten. Others survived but did not gain much fame. Why? Let's find out. Before Belka and Strelka, there were Desik and Zigan. These dogs flew to the Kármán line, the boundary between our atmosphere and outer space. They embarked on this journey on July 22, 1951, from the Kapustin Yar test site. Desik and Zigan became the first higher animals to reach the greatest altitude, about 60 miles. However, they did not go into orbit, which is why they did not become as famous. Both dogs survived. Zigan, however, was scratched during landing and was written off. Desik flew again but met his end in space. Next was Zvezdochka. With only 18 days left before Yuri Gagarin's flight, this brave dog went on a reconnaissance mission aboard Sputnik 10. The flight took place on March 25, 1961, and was a single-orbit mission. This means it completed just one full orbit around Earth. Accompanying the dog was a mannequin named Ivan Ivanovich. The spacecraft landed successfully, but the inhabitants were not immediately found. The weather was bad that day, and the search party delayed their mission. Zvezdochka was found by a passerby who fed and warmed her. The search team arrived later. This flight was the final test of the spacecraft before sending a human into space. If I were a scientist, I would have chosen monkeys over dogs and rats. After all, they are our closest relatives. Soviet scientists considered this option, but it was not pursued. In contrast, American scientists decided otherwise. They were the first to send primates into space in 1958. The first was a monkey named Gordo. He flew on the Jupiter AM-13 spacecraft. The flight was fairly successful, but the detachable capsule deviated from its course and landed in the New Mexico desert. The search team did not act quickly enough, and the so-called astronaut died from the heat. There were other space test subjects. On January 31, 1961, a chimpanzee named Ham flew into space on the Mercury Redstone 2 rocket as part of the Mercury program. The flight lasted 16 minutes and 39 seconds and was the penultimate rehearsal before the first American astronaut's suborbital flight. Ham had an interesting life. He was born in the wild in Cameroon, captured by hunters, and intensively trained for simple tasks, such as pressing a lever within 5 seconds of seeing a flashing blue light. This wild-born monkey not only showed remarkable intelligence, but also charmed everyone with his energy and good mood. On the day of the flight, Ham had his favorite cereal for breakfast and went to the rocket in high spirits. However, not everything went smoothly. The launch was delayed by 4 hours, the G-forces reached incredible levels, and the spacecraft was partially flooded upon landing. Despite all these difficulties, Ham successfully completed the mission and survived. He then lived for another 17 years in zoos and even appeared in a movie. He died on January 19, 1983, at the age of 26, and his remains are buried in the International Space Hall of Fame in New Mexico. But experiments weren't limited to dogs, rats, and monkeys. See, they even sent a cat into space. According to official records, this happened only once. The only documented flight of a cat in space was by France on October 18, 1963. The cat, Felicette, reached an altitude of 100 miles and was safely returned to Earth with a parachute. Electrodes had been implanted in her brain before the flight, and she was observed in a laboratory for 3 months afterward. Unfortunately, for further research, Felicette had to be euthanized. That fall, France attempted to send another cat into space, but the rocket crashed. There were various rumors about this story. Some claimed the first French space cat was actually named Felix, but this was never confirmed. There was also no proof that Brazil sent a cat into space in 1959. This experiment with Felicette or any other cats seems quite strange to me. It's obvious that the unique structure of their musculoskeletal system makes them a poor analog for humans, and they are difficult to train. What do you think? Was this an attempt by France to make history, to be the first in something related to space? Or did they truly learn something new about weightlessness from this peculiar experiment? Okay, I won't be surprised anymore. Can you imagine, in September 1968, scientists decided to send steppe tortoises into space. But it turns out that tortoises were chosen for a reason. Their main advantage over other animals is their ability to go without food and water for extended periods. In weightlessness, they could survive without sustenance for at least a week and a half. Higher animals required special feeders and water dispensers. This experiment had a clear goal: to determine how long-duration flights and G-forces would affect living organisms. The flight lasted a full 7 days. During this time, the tortoises lost more than 10% of their weight, but after returning to Earth, they eagerly ate and soon regained their shape. There were other flights with these reptiles. Three took place in the late 1960s. Two flights were successful, while the last one was not. But the real triumph came in 1975, when tortoises set an incredible record, 90 days in space. This was a truly grand achievement for science and space exploration. By the way, although the tortoises spent many days in space, they didn't manage to create new tortoises there, if you know what I mean. However, jellyfish were quite successful in this regard. In 1991, NASA sent nearly 2,500 jellyfish into Earth's orbit. They returned with a much larger number, 60,000. But American scientists didn't send these creatures to space just for reproduction. We humans are surprisingly similar to jellyfish in how we orient ourselves in space using gravity. We sense gravity and acceleration thanks to otoliths, calcium crystals in our inner ear that move extremely sensitive hair cells. These cells tell our brain which way gravity is pulling us. Jellyfish have a similar mechanism, using it to determine up from down. So jellyfish were sent to space to test how gravity affects the development of an individual from its very beginning, or polyp stage, and to see how the sense of gravity forms in weightlessness. It turned out that space jellyfish indeed had a weaker sense of gravity, and on Earth, they moved very differently from their counterparts who stayed on the planet. Although outwardly, they looked the same. Therefore, if humanity plans to spend several generations traveling to other star systems, we'll need to figure out how to raise children in weightlessness, or of course try to provide full gravity to create the necessary familiar conditions. I believe we are still far from creating colonies on Mars. Incidentally, jellyfish were not the first creatures to be born in space. In 1990, humanity made an incredible leap forward with the biological experiment Quail. Incubators with quail eggs were sent into orbit, and the first chick successfully hatched from its little gray shell. This was an absolute sensation, because now humanity was one step closer to researching life support for crew members on long space missions. After the first chick hatched, more followed. However, their adaptation to weightlessness was extremely difficult. Like little balls of fluff, they floated around the cabin, unable to stabilize themselves. Because of this, they never learned to feed themselves and consequently died. This experiment showed that if we plan long space journeys, we will need to seriously consider how to provide suitable conditions for the growth and development of living beings in weightlessness. Through manned and unmanned space flights, thousands of animals have been to space. Dogs, monkeys, cats, rodents, quails, and even jellyfish. Also, spiders, frogs, newts, grape snails, cockroaches. But more on that another time. What do you think? Are such experiments humane? Share your opinions in the comments. And if you also want to go to space someday, you'll definitely need money for it. Unfortunately, there's no other way. You can earn money right here with our company. We are actively recruiting scriptwriters, announcers, editors, and creative producers. If any of these positions interest you, head over to our Telegram bot and apply. Thanks for watching.